Sandra Evertson and Prima Marketing developed the Relics and Artifacts collection, which is the subject of today's midweek news video. We'll look at elements in the collection, how to add color, glimmer, and embellishments to create lovely antique-inspired pieces. Included in the Relics and Artifacts collection is a big assortment of shapes, hearts and ex-votos, milagros, cameos, all kinds of pieces with wonderful detail and texture. They're manufactured from a blend of resin and plaster, and they're porous so that they're actually sandable, and I'm going to show you that in 1 second. Let me go ahead and move these out of the way, but I'm going to bring this one back just for a second, and you'll notice that we have the flame attached to the heart. Now, as the hearts generally come from the package, they have a screw eye in them like this, so let me show you what I'm talking about. All right, so this is the collection that's called Flaming Hearts Ex Votos 2, and I'm going to open this up, and one of the things that you'll notice is that both of these hearts actually have a screw eye in them. And so removing them is actually really straightforward. Just grab yourself a pair of pliers and go ahead and just unscrew this. And it will back right out of the hole that it's in. And save that because you'll see afterward one of the finished pieces I have to show you actually will utilize this. Now, if you don't have a little screw eye that's left over, you can certainly pick them up. Tim Holtz has screw eyes that are available in 3 colors in the same package, so that's workable too. Now, in terms of them being sandable, one of the things that I want to show you, I just want to grab a piece here that has a little edge on it so you can see what I mean. I'm just kind of looking through here. All right, so here's a good example. If you look at this piece right here, see this edge right here, how it's not perfectly flat? I'm just trying to turn that. You can actually take this off, whether you use your fingers or you use some pliers like I'm doing here. You can snap that little bit of extra material off. Whoops, grab yourself some sandpaper. Now this is 220 grit, so it's really fine. And then just come and sand that uneven edge off, and then you'll have a nice, perfectly smooth piece. Now, I'm not going to do this whole thing, but that's the process. Now, one of the reasons that it's important that you can sand these, aside from being able to clean up a little bit of extra that hangs off the edge like that, is because when you put these together, see how they're not matching up perfectly? They really need to be more like this, and that means that you can see this arc because I have to lift this in order to get it correct. So what you'll have to do is grab some sandpaper and start sanding till eventually you end up with these pieces so they sit flush like this while they're lying on the surface, so you know that they're going to line up perfectly. Now, you could certainly put these together, and I use E6000 glue. You can certainly put them together like this, but they're going to make, well, it's hard for me to show you, but they're going to make, whoops, a little bit of an arc. So just, it takes just a few minutes. You just want to come in here and start sanding, and you can see that you can get this stuff to come right off on the paper, so it's going to sand. And what you'll want to do is figure out where, like I know that this is a high spot right here, so I need to sand the front of this piece, and I would just patiently do this for however long it took until I got these pieces so that they were flat and lined up properly, and that's really going to be important. So in terms of what to do with these, they are just begging for bling and glitter. Now, if that's not your thing, then obviously you don't have to go there, but you can see I have some samples here. I use a lot of metallic paint. I'm using the Myogold paint. That's what's here and here, and that's what's surrounding here. I'm also going to show you how you can use some Inca Gold. That's part of what I have going on here and here, and certainly what's going on here. I can show you, I will show you how to create a wash, and we're going to kind of put some color on here and then wipe a lot of it off so that we get those recesses highlighted, and then we'll come along with Inca Gold to hit the high spots, which will add some glimmer there. I think glitter is a perfect embellishment for these, and especially this new style that I'm working with that is very, very fine. It almost looks like a glimmery suede. That's what's on here. Now, this is 2 coats, and we'll talk about that in a second. This is a product from Elizabeth Craft Designs. It's called Silk Microfine Glitter, and it is incredibly fine. I know it's a little hard for you to see, but I know you can see the glimmer in there, and when I dump this out, you're going to see that it almost creates a cloud of powder. It's so fine, but you get a really nice look with it. Now, having said that, this is two coats. It seems like no matter what I do, when I apply the gel medium, I'm not as thorough as I think I'm being, and there's always a spot that's a little bit light, or you'll come back and touch this and there'll be glitter on a spot where you entirely missed with the gel medium, and obviously you have to fix it. Now, I've tried to just patch the areas in. It does not work well at all. You end up with a very obvious looking patch. So my solution is to use two coats of glitter. They don't take long to do, but the one thing that you must do is exercise a little patience and let the gel medium dry. So I'm going to start with just a big flat brush, and the thing that you have to do is work relatively quickly. It's April here, and so the heat is not running all that much, and it's not terribly warm out yet. It's kind of one of those in-between places, but the gel medium is liable to dry before you can, or any glue for that matter, is liable to dry before you get finished and start applying the glitter if you waste too much time. So what I'm going to do, this is the matte gel medium, and I'm going to get a fair amount on my brush, and I'm using a large brush so I can cover a lot of acreage at once. I want to get this coat on there. I want it to be a nice even coat, but I need to get it done so that I can move on to applying the glitter. All right, so here's the first coat, and let me grab a piece of paper towel and just wipe that gel medium up. Now I'm going to work on a piece of deli paper. This is actually really handy. It's disposable and it helps you contain the mess. Now what I do need to do is come back and just where I've touched this, I want to just come back and touch a little bit of glitter. Now as I said, you're going to do two coats anyway, so if you miss a tiny bit, it's not the end of the world. You can catch it the second time around. I want to make certain that I don't have any big lumps, and then I'm going to go ahead and dump this glitter on. And again, as I said, you can see how incredibly fine it is. Now I want to get this on all the edges, so I'm going to practically dump out the entire jar, and then I'm going to do this to kind of move the glitter up the sides so that it's touching everything, and that way I don't actually have to touch it. So that's it, it's glittered, and what you got to do is leave it alone. You got to give it however much time it takes is however much time it takes, and I can't tell you what that's going to be, but leave it alone, let it dry. I'm going to come back in a second, and I'm going to show you how easy it is to work with the Maya Gold paint. This is two quick coats, and it gives it a really beautiful look. Because Maya Gold is so heavily pigmented and metallicized, it really is perfect for the Relics and Artifacts. I've used it here. I've used bronze, and then I came back and just touched silver to the depressed areas around this heart. It's what I used here. This is silver that is in this beaded section around here. And actually, before I go too much further, something I should have said in the last section. Now, as you look at this, you're going to see some light areas. That's because this outer piece has not had its second coat of glitter yet. But what I should have said when I showed you how to glitter the last time but couldn't because I was working on a solid piece that there were no edges on, when I apply gel medium and then I dump the glitter over it, I dump the excess off, and then I come back with, and you can see that there's a little bit of glitter on this brush. Let me just knock that off. I come back with a brush similar to this. It's something soft, and what I can do is I can use it to just gently, if the gel medium has crept over into this beaded area, I can use it to gently do something along these lines to push it back out of the way, and then ultimately, when the glitter is thoroughly dry, I can use it to come back and just kind of sweep the area where there's not supposed to be glitter and remove anything that's in there. So let me just grab another brush and I can show you. The Maya Gold is, as I said, it's wonderful and it works really well with this. Just go ahead and give this a little bit of a shake. I'm just trying to knock the glitter off my hands because it's going to get in the paint. Not that it really will matter all that much, I suppose. So what I have to one side here, I have a toothpick. What I want to do is so I can paint both sides of this. As I get to the end, or maybe I'll just do this now, I want to put this on a toothpick, and then I'm going to suspend it between two glasses and let it dry, and that way both sides can dry and I won't have to worry about anything marring either of the surfaces. So it's just a question of coming in and applying a reasonably liberal coat. You don't obviously want drips and runs and all kinds of messy stuff. Don't bother this or you're going to have to sand it off. Even though E6000 is meant for use on porous surfaces, I will, something again that I should have said a moment ago, I will come back with scissors once everything's dry, and I'm just going to put some scratches in here. It just roughens the surface here and on the top of the heart enough so that it really gives the E6000 something to grab onto. All right, so let's just go ahead and get this coat on here, and I will do the back. And then I'm going to talk about Inca Gold and how you can use it as a wash, and then how you can use it to go ahead and apply over to the onto the high areas. Actually, you know what? I'm not going to bother with the back now. You don't need to see me paint the back. I'm just going to go ahead and make certain that there's no heaviness on here, that it's all spread out and it's nice and smooth. I'm going to dunk my brush in some water, and then I'm going to take this and suspend it between the two glasses and just let it do its thing. All right. Wipe my fingers on some paper towels. So the nice thing about Inca Gold is that because it's a water-based product, you can go ahead and you can thin it out with water. Sorry, brain cramp there. All right, so let me just grab a palette and again kind of sweep some of this glitter out of the way. I'm going to do that one afterward. What I want to do is take, this is graphite, I believe. Yep, the hematite is another dark color. You can use either one of them. It doesn't make any difference, and you don't need very much. I want to create a really thin wash of this, so I'm going to squeeze a little bit of water into that. Grab my brush, and I just want to take a moment and kind of blend those little chunks that I pulled out of the container with the water to create a wash. And then what that's going to allow me to do, actually I think it was this one that I wanted to do this to, I'm just going to come in here and tap the color in, and if I think this is a little bit too thin, I can always come back and pick up a little bit more of the Inca Gold, of the graphite Inca Gold rather, and I can darken this a little bit. Yeah, I think that's better. Now, I know initially you're horrified thinking that this looks just awful, but it won't for long, I promise. So now with that done, I'm going to grab some paper towel, and what I want to do is use this to allow the graphite color to settle in the crevices, and that really makes them stand out. It provides the contrast so that you can see those recessed areas. When they're all the same color, they're a lot harder to see. And once this is dry, and at this point it doesn't take very much to dry it just because I've mopped up most of the product, but once this is, I'm going to get right in there. And if you think that this looks awful, go take it under the sink and rinse it off. Most of the products that I've used will rinse right off. Some of them stain a little bit, but because this is that plaster material and the resin mix, a lot of the color will just come right off and you can more or less start from scratch. All right, so that looks pretty good. And actually, now this is dry enough, I'm going to take Inca Gold with my finger, and I'm just going to come along here, and I'm going to hit all the high spots. And I'm going to, this is silver Inca Gold, and the other was, like I said, either graphite or you can use hematite. Either one of them are dark enough for this technique. And I'm just going to come in here and do this. And that's it. Bob's your uncle. It's that simple. The other thing that you can do if you want is to just use Inca Gold by itself. Now, this is from a different selection, different assortment than this is. These are cameos. I can't remember what these are. These really three-dimensional ones, they're sold separately. But nevertheless, what you can do is I can just come in and lightly touch the Inca Gold and catch the high spots on here. And it provides a really beautiful, subtle sheen. And you can do this with any color. I've just chosen to go ahead and use silver. But you see how effective this is. Very subtle, very, very beautiful. You don't have to go with tons of glitter if you don't want, but certainly something like this really does allow the detail to show, and it's really pretty when you get done. So as I turn this, you can see how much more the detail is evident on this cameo than it was before. So, you know, I've showed you various ways to put color on here. One other way that I want to show you is you can use something like Lindy's Starburst sprays. Now this is Magnolia Magenta Gold, and this is Creme Brulee Cream. So I did this one with Creme Brulee Cream, and it's very, very subtle. There's not a ton to see here, and I'm hoping that you can see it as I kind of turn this in the light. Again, down in the crevices, the mica powder that's in here, and you can see it's kind of a gold color, has settled down in there, and with a paper towel, I took the most of it off. I did the same thing here, And this one was done with the Magnolia Magenta Gold, and you can see that that's the pink up here, but the gold has settled down into the crevices. So that you can see it, and I want to get all this stuff out of the way so I don't get any overspray. Let me show you how this works. You're just going to go ahead and spray it very liberally, and then I like to pick it up and just kind of drag it through what's on the table. That way I get some on the back as well. And then you're just going to do the same thing that we did with the Graphite Inca Gold. You're going to tap to remove as much of the excess as you want, remembering that where it settles into the recesses, not only will you get the color of the spray, but because the Lindys are two-toned, you're also going to get the color of the mica that's in there. So I would just probably go ahead and do this just to clean some of that excess out. And of course, there's lots of colors in the Lindy's Starburst spray line, so you're sure to find something that works with whatever it is that you're creating these for. All right, so there's that. Now, with this done, I want to come back in a minute, once I get cleaned up, and I want to show you rhinestone chain, which is what's surrounding this this rope area here that's silver. We have flatback rhinestones and some other bits here, I'm sure, that would be really wonderful for embellishing with. There are many, many ways that you can embellish these. I'm choosing to use Preziosa Czech rhinestone chain, and of course I've used glitter and the metallic paint. I'm also using Swarovski flatback rhinestones, which you can see here. So let's talk about the chain for a second. We have it in two sizes. This is called stone size 6, and these are pretty small. They measure about 1/16 of an inch in diameter. And then the next size up is this SS or stone size 12, and we have it in this raw brass finish on the setting that you can see here, and you don't actually see all that much of it, but we also have it in this silver finish, and so everything, because the crystals are clear, everything is just kind of silver colored there. I've used a little bit of both, and I want to show you how I apply them. Now, what I do is I cut the piece to length, and so bear in mind that this chain moves, it flexes, and so when you are laying your piece of chain on the area where you want it to go, and I'm just going to kind of start here, and I use my awl for this because it helps me. I have pretty small hands, but it helps me kind of align things. So what I do is lay this in place, and I just want to turn it so you can see it, and I allow for this idea that this chain will contract a little bit because it has that spacer in between, and I find the correct length, and then it's just a question of using wire cutters. And so let me just show you on this piece, because I'm going to show you too that you can actually use these pieces individually, and we'll get there, but all you have to do is use your wire cutters and go ahead and snip that little piece between, and on one side it's closed off, and on the other the piece actually will, or it's, excuse me, it's not closed off, it's attached directly to the base of the setting, and on the other side is where the piece slides in and out, and you might see them occasionally slip out, you might be able to clip them off, but for the most part they just kind of fall back inside the setting and you never see them. So I'm going to use the Aileen's Super Thick Tacky Glue to put this in place, because obviously we have chain that is a non-porous surface, and we're going to attach it to paint, which pretty much dries to an, at least the metallic paint does, dries to a non-porous surface. Now, the process is the same, and I'm not going to make you sit here and watch me attach this chain, but it's a question of laying down a bead of glue and then going ahead and putting the chain in place. Now, I will tell you that typically what I will do so that the glue doesn't start to skin over before I can actually get back to put the chain in it, I'll put down some glue, I'll lay the chain almost all the way into it, I'll leave some of it hanging off, I'll put down the next section of glue, move the chain in place, blah blah, until I'm at the end. But let me just show you here. So this is the original Ex Votos that I started with. This is, and I forgot to mention the colors on the glitter. This is antique silver glitter. This one in here, this is champagne gold, whoops, this is saffron, and this is antique gold. So just in case you're wondering, and we'll have these too. All right, so now what I've done is I've used the version of the stone size 12 chain on the neck of this Ex Votos, and I've used the silver color on the bottom piece where I've got the antique silver glitter. And here I'm going to use the raw brass color. It just kind of blends a little bit more. So I'm going to take my glue, and I'm going to go ahead and put a line of glue on this piece of the neck right here. You obviously need enough glue so that this will stay in place, but not so much that you end up with a mess squished out all over the place. Now the good news is that the glue dries clear, but it will also dry in such a way that you might be able to see it, so just be cautious about how you're applying the glue. I think I need just a tiny bit more right there. I've got kind of a thin spot. And from here, it's really straightforward because I've of course pre-cut this chain. All I need to do is lay it in place. Now what I want to do is align the two stones so that they are all lined up evenly. And now it's just a question of, and again, I can use this awl to kind of get things moved. Even though I have small hands, it can be hard to get in here. Now, what I will caution you is, and I just glued this silver one on here a moment ago. The glue has not dried enough so that I can't move this, and I needed to actually slide the whole thing back. This raw brass color chain was actually tipping forward. It wasn't quite far enough on the neck. So when you do these, make sure you do them at the same time so you allow yourself the flexibility to make adjustments as needed, whether it's front to back or top to bottom as I just had to. And then it's just a matter of, once again, being patient, not my strong suit, but being patient, putting this to one side and letting it dry. And I think that this looks magnificent. I think that the rhinestones add a beautiful look to this. Now, as I said, you can cut these rhinestones apart. This is another one of these little flaming hearts, and you can see that this is the larger of the two. These are the SS12 stones. What I'm going to do is either paint this silver or put some silver glitter on here, and then I'm going to arrange these all around the raised heart surface. Now, in addition to that, if I wanted to, let's just bring this one back in. Talking again about the fact, you know what, it's easier to do with tweezers. Talking about the fact that these can be cut and used separately, I have to get my second coat of the antique gold glitter on here, but I think I'm going to do something like this. Just a little bit, kind of following the arc of this piece, and I will put these five stones on here. And I think that this will look really cool. Something's stuck on there, so of course. But you get the point. I would, again, use the Aliens Tacky Glue so that everything stays in place. And there you go. Now, again, flat back rhinestones will work too, as long as you've got a nice flat area to put them on. This is just the barest beginnings of the ways that you can embellish these. There's an incredible array of things that you can do. I have one finished piece that I want to come back and very quickly show you, something that I did with one of the Milagros. It's actually an arm, although shaped a little bit different than this, and a deep wrapped canvas. Sorry, it'll make sense when I show it to you a second. I've actually created a little display piece. This is the piece I mentioned a moment ago. It's a niche that I created using a deep gallery wrapped canvas, and it's a nice little display piece that's incredibly easy to do. Now these canvases vary. This is a 5x5, and they vary. Sometimes there's a set of stretcher bars. Well, there's always a set of stretcher bars around the outside. Sometimes there's another set in here, but generally on a 5x5 canvas, you'll end up with a niche that's about 2 or 2.5 inches square in opening there, and it's perfect for this Milagro. This is from the actual Milagro set, and included in that set are some another hand and two legs. There's some little figures and this set of feet here. So these are traditional Milagros, and all I did was take Ranger's matte texture paste and Dina's palette knife, and I just kind of randomly applied it so that I got lots of texture. I didn't want flat. I wanted a very uneven looking surface. Once it was dry, I used the silver Inca gold, and I came in and with my fingers, just like you saw me do earlier, and I just rubbed it on in various places. Some of it caught in the highlights, some of it's down low, but either way, it gets this nice, real reflective silvery look on there. So this is a very basic piece. Now, I did the same thing here. This is, on this particular piece, I used the silver Inca gold. I watered it down, and I kind of spread it all over, let it dry just a moment, and then I patted some of it off. And then ultimately, I used one of the screw eyes left over from when I took a piece out of, or took one out of one of the hearts. And then I used one of Tim Holtz's jump rings from the Ideology collection and hung that in there. It's a little bit fiddly to do, but in the end, it makes such a nice piece that I really thought that it was worth it. So, you know, there's lots of other ways that you can use these. This is just the barest beginning, but these are a wonderful group of ornamental pieces that I know you're going to enjoy working with.